Hello student, I am your APD ma'am. Today we are going to discuss the second part of our subunit organisms and population. And today's topic is interaction of biotic factors with the abiotic factors. Now let's start our discussion with the term abiotic factor. Now abiotic factors are natural and non-living factor. They are temperature, water, light, soil, humidity, okay. And these abiotic factors are very important for the structure, life history, physiology and the behavior of the organism. Now let's see, temperature is important for reproduction, the sex ratio of the organism, metabolism, growth and development of the organism. And light is also important for photosynthesis, movement of the organisms, seed germination, coat color of the organisms. And water is very important for our survival, because inside the cell all the metabolic activities are running in presence of water molecules, and it's also the medium of transportation and the survival of the cell. Now the next one is the soil. Soil is important for the growth and development of the plant. It is the habitat of the microorganisms and the source of the minerals. Now see, the abiotic factors are different in different regions of the earth, and depending upon it we can divide the earth into several biomes. Let's see. Now the first one is the Arctic and Alpine tundra. Next one is coniferous forest. Third one, temperate forest. Fourth one, tropical forest. Fifth one, grassland. And the last one is the desert. Now see, in every case the mean annual temperature and mean annual precipitation is different, and it's also determine the diversity of the organisms in the biomes. And it's also different in each and every cases. Okay, let's see. In case of Arctic and Alpine tundra, the mean annual temperature is about from 0 to minus 10 degrees centigrade. And the precipitation is from 50 to 100 centimeter. And in case of coniferous forest, the temperature is from 0 to 15 degree centigrade, and the precipitation from 62 to 50 centimeter. And in case of temperate forest, the temperature is 10 to 22 or 25 degree centigrade, and the precipitation is about from 60 to 220 centimeter. And in case of tropical forest, the temperature is from 20 to 25 degree centigrade, but the precipitation is about 150 to 440 or 430 centimeter. And in case of desert, the temperature is about 5 degree to 25 degree centigrade, and here the precipitation is very very low, and it's less than 50 centimeter. Okay, now the next concept is zone of tolerance. Now see the graph. In the x-axis we take the gradient of environmental factors, and at the y-axis we take the abundance of individual. Now see, it gives a bell-shaped curve, and at the middle region, the bell shape, here we get the highest number of organisms. Okay, now this range of environmental factor is known as the optimal area of tolerance. That means at these environmental factors, individuals can't exhibit their all the physiological, all the biological activity at their highest level. Okay, after that, if we go towards the maximum and the minimum point, then gradually the abundance of the organism becomes low, and this range is known as zone of physiological stress. Okay, and after that, at this region there is no organisms, and this zone is known as zone for endurance limit. Okay, now according to the range of tolerance, we can divide the organisms into two categories, and we can explain them with two prefix. First one is eud, and second one is the steno. Now eud means wide range of tolerance. That means in that case, organism has high tolerance range. That means they can survive if the abiotic factors are fluctuated from their optimum position. Okay. But in case of stenohaline, they have very narrow range of tolerance. That's why if the abiotic factors are shifted from their optimal range, then their mortality rate is gradually increased. Okay. Now, eurehalines are birds and mammals, and stenohalines are the lower grades of animals. Okay. Now the next concept, response of organism to the abiotic factors. Now all the abiotic factors or the environmental situation are fluctuating, and to cope up with this changing environment, organisms try to adapt themselves. Okay, and for this they adopt some processes. Okay, the first concept is regulator and conformant. Now see here the graph. If we take the external level at the x-axis and internal level at the y-axis, internal level means the physiological condition. Okay, now see here, in case of conformer, according to the external level, their internal level is also changing. And in case of regulator, they are independent upon the external level. That means conformer cannot regulate their internal environment or internal body condition. Their internal environment changes with the ambient condition, and the examples are reptiles, amphibians, and they cannot regulate their body temperature. Their body temperature is also fluctuating with the ambient temperature. Okay, now the next one is the regulator. That means they can maintain their internal environment at a specific level. For example, birds and mammals can regulate their own body temperature by thermoregulation. Okay, now another mode of cope up is the migration. Now, migration is a process when all the population of the organisms are coming from their position to another position. Now, there are lots of examples. First one is the Siberian crane, and they travel a long distance for their reproduction, and they came from the Siberian region to the Bharatpur National Park for their reproduction. Okay, now the next very common example is the Hilsa. For their spawning, they came to the river region. Okay, and another one is the wild beast. They also travel for their food from Kenya to the South Africa. Okay, now another example is the sea turtle and also the Arctic tern. Now the next strategy is the suspension. That means to cope up with the changing environment, they suspend their body functioning, and there are three strategies. First one is hibernation, that is the winter cell. That means here the organisms metabolically inactive or less active to avoid the extreme cold condition, for example the polar bear. And activation is the summer cell. Here during summer they becomes metabolically inactive or very less active. Example, snail, round squirrel. Okay, now the next one is the diapause. Now to avoid the herd condition, they actually pause their development. Not only the metabolism, all the development process is paused, and this is known as diapause, and it is found in the zooplankton, insects. Okay, now the next strategy is the adaptation. Now to cope up with the changing environment, organisms develop some feature, and this is known as the adaptation. Now take an example of desert adaptation, and here the plants roots are spread for the absorption of the water molecules, and stem are capable to store the water molecules, and they have the spine to protect the plants from the predator, and also it's reduced the rate of transpiration, that means loss of water. Okay, and in case of animals, let's take an example of camel. Here their eyelashes are very long to prevent the sandstorm, and they have hump in which they store the fat molecules, and by degrading the fat molecules they actually extract the water molecules. Okay, they have the padded feet which is very important for the walking on the hot sand. Okay, now if we see the adaptation, now there are some ecogeographic rules. That means over the geographical gradients, the variation, the trait, the morphology of the organisms are different. Okay, now see, first one is the Allen's rule, and according to this rules, the endotherms from colder climates usually have shorter limbs or appendages than the warmer climate. Now see here, the jackrabbit and the snow hare. Okay, now see, in case of jackrabbit, the ears are, or the pinna is very large, whereas in case of snow hare it is small. Okay, now in the Bergman's rule, in this case the warmer parts regions animals have smaller body size, whereas in case of cooler part they have larger body size. Okay, and Clogger's rule, according to this rule, the organism present in the warmer condition have very bright and dark pigmentation, whereas in the polar region or cold region they have their light pigmentation. And in this case, the warmer region, the production of the melanin is high to prevent the heat of the sunlight and also the sun rays, the UV protection. Okay, now the another rule is Wilson's rule, and according to this rule, the animals present in the Arctic region or the cooler part, they have a thick layer of fat just beneath the skin, and it prevent to loss of heat. Okay, now see here, in case of polar bear and elephant. Okay, now polar bear is adapted in the polar region, and that's why for camouflaging they have whitish appearance, and whereas elephant is found in the tropical region, they have dark pigmentation. Okay, and in case of polar bear, they have padded feet so that they can move on the snow and ice, and in case of elephant, they have big ears to release the extra heat of the body. Okay, now the another very relevant adaptation is the altitude sickness. Now it is found when we travel in any high altitude region, we feel our breathing becomes faster, our heartbeat becomes faster, and we urinate very frequently, and our blood becomes thicker. But why? Now at the higher altitude region, the concentration of the oxygen is very low, and to give the availability of the oxygen to each and every body cells, our circulatory system must be very fast, and that's why the heart beats faster. And to get the enough oxygen from the ambient temperature, our breathing rate is also becomes higher, and here the hemoglobin molecules frequently release the oxygen molecules to the cell. Okay, that means the binding between the hemoglobin and the RBC becomes very looser. Okay, now this is all about the interaction between the biotic and abiotic factor. Thank you.